Well, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us. And I'd like to welcome everyone to the second of our carbon talks for 2017. On the title of Towards a Circular City, given by Jacqueline Cramer, whose bio I'll give you in a moment. Just for those of you who have not attended one of these before, I expect a few more people will come in. They're being live streamed at the back, so we try to start pretty promptly at 12:30 and conclude at 1:30. If people would like to speak with Jacqueline after the talk, perhaps they could come up afterwards and just informally carry on a conversation if there's issues that you want to explore with her further. We archive the live stream, and so it goes up as a podcast on our Carbon Talks YouTube channel. People can, of course, once Jacqueline's presentation is finished, we'll use the bulk of the time for questions and comments. We're also very happy to take questions for the remote audience, of whom there are more than 30 people watching online, by sending questions via Twitter to @CarbonTalks. And you can also follow the conversation with #CarbonTalks. I always like to thank our funders for this event series, the North Growth Foundation, the Pacific Institutes for Climate Solutions, and of course the SFU Center for Dialogue, which we're a part. In particular, I'd like to thank the UBC Killam Connection, which brought Jacqueline Cramer to Vancouver this week. She mentioned to me she gave a public lecture for over 100 people at Robson Square for UBC on Monday, and we're delighted that she's been able to find some time to join us as part of our Carbon Talks series here at SFU. There's a couple of sign-up sheets going around the room for people, for those of you for whom this might be the first time that you've come to one of these events. If you'd like to hear, attend other Carbon Talks, and also if you'd like to sign up for the Pacific Institute's weekly Climate and Energy Bulletin. When we move over to questions, I'll just say a couple of other organizational things. And now just to introduce our speaker, Dr. Jacqueline Cramer. She's the Circular Economy Ambassador for the Amsterdam Economic Board. I imagine you can explain what a circular economy ambassador does. She's also a professor of sustainable innovation at Utrecht University and a strategic advisor at Utrecht Sustainability Institute. Not so long ago, she was the Netherlands Minister for Environment, Housing and Spatial Planning under an earlier government. And she's had a long-standing relationship with the Amsterdam Economic Board and has been a professor in the area of environmental management and sustainable innovation since 1990. I think that covers the essence. With no further elaboration, I'd like to turn the microphone over to you.
Thank you so much. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's really a pleasure to be here. And my talk will be about the circular city and especially about the experiences I like to share with you coming from the Netherlands. Well, why do we have to strive for a circular city? Well, my answer is simple. To reduce the excessive use of resources and the environmental impact going with it, we need to move from a linear economy based on a throwaway society, one-time use, to a circular economy. And what does it mean? That means that we have to close the loops of both products and materials, and at the same time safeguard the restorative capacity of natural ecosystems. That is, in essence, what it is all about. This is, of course, an enormous challenge to realize such a circular economy. We are not completely linear anymore because we already do some things in this area, for instance, recycling. But my message is we can do so much more to reduce the excessive use of resources, and we can go for it. When I talk about resources, we can talk about water, energy, and raw materials. Because of time constraints, I will concentrate on what we do with respect to the circular economy and raw materials. And telling the story, I always like to start with a positive message, namely the message that circular economy can gain a lot of profits. not only in terms of financial benefits, but also in terms of social and environmental benefits. Here you can see what different well-known consultancy firms have calculated with respect to the financial benefits in Europe, in Netherlands, and worldwide. These are tremendous figures, very hopeful. At the same time, you see that it can also lead to indirect merits, namely, for instance, the development of new knowledge, new business development, new innovations, and also, of course, the decrease of the environmental burden. This is all about the positive merits that can be achieved in the long run. Major challenges, of course, how can we come from here to there? That first needs investments. So it is not right away a positive story when you start. But what I'm doing as an ambassador and actually as a kind of change agent in the metropolitan area Amsterdam is to mobilize positive forces to make business cases possible into the direction of a circular economy. Well, many people also this week ask me, how do I start? You know, it's such a huge topic. Well, we have developed this ladder of circularity, which for us is a really handy instrument. It actually shows how you can give priority to the options that are as high as possible on the ladder, because they are to be preferred. The highest step is, of course, not using resources. Then we need to reduce resources per product unit. If that is not possible, then you can go to all kinds of options for product reuse. And that starts, of course, by redesigning products in such a way that they can be brought back after use into the cycle again and again and again. That's one, redesign. Then you can go to product reuse, using bottles, for instance, several times. Next step is to go to the product repair, product refurbishing, product remanufacturing. That means that you, for instance, upgrade your mobile phone. And repurpose. That means that you again use the product, but with another function. All these different product reuse options need to be much more promoted and implemented. If that is not possible anymore and the product has to be discarded, we go to recycling. And there, of course, it is important to recycle, but we strive for high-grade recycling. I come back to that in a minute. So that is what we do, and if recycling is not possible anymore, then the residual waste can be incinerated in the form of waste to energy. Well, of course, many people say, it's so difficult, there are so many barriers, institutional barriers, organizational barriers, legal barriers, economic barriers, behavior barriers, and of course also technical barriers. But you know, when you just focus on that, you don't start to move. And I prefer to talk about opportunities, and my experience is when there is a willingness to change, all these barriers can more or less be overcome. So let's just start is my message. Then the question, of course, is how do you start? And many municipalities in the Netherlands are the last years very eager to take the lead in this endeavor. And that is a real good thing. Why? Because all the nice policies about circular economy need to be put in place in cities, in regions. There it is happening. And not, of course, only the local government is in charge, but it is something that should be a joint endeavor with stakeholders such as industry, knowledge institutes, and citizens, and of course the local governments. And in order to set up a program, we designed this step-by-step plan in order to support municipalities in their efforts. I will go through this step-by-step plan in order to explain what we mean by the various steps. Let me first go to step one, that is map promising resource streams. Well, in the metropolitan area Amsterdam, you know, we have a lot of resource streams, both products circulating in our region, as well as all kinds of materials. And of course, you can't do everything at once. So we said, let's focus on a number of resource streams which are evidently possibilities for better options. So you can see here on the screen the various nine streams that we identified. Biomass streams, diversified in different substreams, the construction and demolition sector, the electronic and electric waste sector, the non-wearable textiles, the plastics, the incontinence and diapers materials, the mattresses, servers of ICT sector, and metals. That are the main focal resource streams that we want to bring into a much higher loop in the years 2015 to 2018. So after that period, we have to get everything in place. So it's quite ambitious. Second step in the step-by-step plan is to analyze the options for improvement. You analyze these options together with the different stakeholders in very targeted settings. And then you have to decide what is actually the most appropriate scale at which you need to increase the performance. Sometimes it's the municipal scale, which is okay. Sometimes you need a scale of the region or sub-region or supra-region in order to create a valuable business case. Let me explain that on the basis of some examples. Here is the example of a case which easily can be organized at municipal level. That is circular demolition and construction of buildings. If you do a good job, you can practically recycle all the materials when you tear down a building. That's not happening yet, but it is possible, and at municipal scale. Similarly, most of the initiatives related to product reuse also take place at municipal level. There are new businesses that coming into action to make, for instance, products which are called circular. Whether it is an initiative for better repair or repurpose or even redesign in combination with reuse. All kinds of activities are taking place and should be nourished at a municipal level. When we go to electronic and electric waste, then you see that you actually need a little higher scale in order to set up, for instance, sorting centers to dismantle the electronic equipment. And in order to recycle the different parts that you have dismantled, you even need a higher scale. Sometimes the region and sometimes even supra-region, to interest a business that is really willing to invest in recycling high-grade these various resources. Similarly, when we go to biomass, and I explained that there are various types of biomass. In most of these cases, we also need a scale which is sub-regional or regional. Why? Take, for example, the biodegradable household waste. Of course, you can create biogas installations and recover energy. But what actually our target is to go one step further and say, no, we have to get all the chemical components and fibers out of the biomass and produce, for instance, pulp and paper and chemical compounds of it. We call that the bio-based economy. To set up a biorefinery that can do that needs a scale in order to be interesting for investors. They need volume, and they also need a certainty about the markets that are demanding the products that are being recovered. Similarly, when we go to the textiles, you are all familiar with the textile recycling, the collection of textiles. In the Netherlands, only 1/3 is secondhand and profitable. The rest, 2/3, is unwearable and is most of the time incinerated or at best used for insulation. We want to do more. We want to make sure that we sort the textiles by sort, and then we want to get the fibers back into new products. That is possible, but to organize that, you need scale. You need the commitment of various municipalities to provide the non-wearables to a specific company. And the company then can make business knowing that they have certainty about volume, and also they need the certainty about their demand, the market. Okay, when you know that, then you... there is another example of the plastics that I need to explain first before I go to the next step. And that is that plastics also need a scale which is regional and sometimes even supra-regional. Why? Because the installations to really sort the different plastics in such a way that it are very high quality streams, resources that are asked by the market, then you really need investments in highly qualified equipment. So you need scale. And also you need certainty about volume and about the markets. Similarly, the mattresses. We collect mattresses and try to recycle them at the moment, but what is the case? The recycling at the moment is not profitable. Here we need to work together with the whole supply chain, including the producers of the mattresses, like IKEA, also stimulate them to redesign their mattresses in order to make recycling more cradle to cradle and more profitable in that way. And we also involve here the recyclers that are in place to do a better job in recycling. This is a national initiative that is taking place at the moment, and we hope this year to settle a deal with all the partners in the chain to get started with recycling and redesign of mattresses. So that are some examples to show that we can do much more. And the challenge is, of course, to set up a short-term and long-term strategy that makes this all possible and be implemented. And how then do you get all these things off the ground? That is, of course, the major question. I can explain that in the dialogue after this talk. I didn't talk about involving the public yet, but that is crucial. And I always tell the municipalities, please be clear and communicate as much as possible about the need to separate waste, but also why. What are we going to do with it? And are we really going to make the change towards a circular economy? People need to believe it, otherwise they are not going to join you. So that's why I have one action point related to optimize the collection of resource streams, but also the communication about it. Then fifth step in the step-by-step plan, that is that you can, of course, set up all these systems also at higher scale, but be aware that what is happening bottom up is crucial for the whole movement towards a circular economy. So also all these smaller initiatives should not be set aside like, oh, they are too small. No, they are part of the movement. Whether it is a startup that wants to try out something new, or whether there are people that are involved in trying to share, for instance, equipment when you repair your house, peer buy, then you can share equipment. Flow 2 is the similar initiative, but then for the professional market, so that people don't buy all the equipment themselves, but just lease them. And also all kinds of initiatives to lease, for instance, LED instead of buying them. These are really good development. People in the neighborhood start to think about what is really going to happen. Then the last step is to set up a circular procurement policy. This is really key for municipalities. Circular procurement is an instrument to really steer the market in a circular direction, both for product reuse and all the opportunities that I explained in that area, but also for high-grade recycling. If there is no trigger in the market, the industry will say, we are not asked to do it, and they will not act. And the interesting thing is that actually the market asks the municipalities and also the other actors like companies to set in motion a public procurement policies related to circularity, because then there is a level playing field. So they are not against it, but they want to have clarity about it. So here is a real task for the municipalities and all those who are commissioning clients. My conclusion is that it is possible to move towards a circular city, and there are a number of conditions for success that I will summarize. In the first place, you need to have initiators with guts and support of those who need to be involved. In the metropolitan area Amsterdam, I am one of these initiators, but there are more people like me in the region that really want to take the lead. So what the challenge is to orchestrate the process, and as soon as there is a consortium that says, we see an opportunity and we will express our commitment to do it, then we, as the ones who initiate the initiative, can step back and the people can continue their own effort. Secondly, it is important to have cooperation in supply chains and in the region in order to get things off the ground. All my examples show that a company or one municipality can't do the job alone. In most of the cases we have implemented up to now and are developing, new financial arrangements are really key. When everybody is trying to gain the profit themselves and not sharing costs and benefits, it's really hard to come up with the best business cases. And finally, there are a number of additional tailor-made initiatives to be taken that are really incentives to get things off the ground. And one of the major ones is circular procurement. Well, I'm really pleased to answer all the questions, because I'm sure that although I explained some of the issues, there are lots of questions that need to be answered. Thank you so much for your attention.
So, Angela has a microphone, which she'll take around the audience. If you could just raise your hand to indicate those of you who'd like to ask questions. Great, we've already got a couple at the back. Could you just briefly introduce yourself, give us your name, and if you'd like to give us an institutional affiliation, that helps us know who's here in the room. And also, I encourage people who are watching online to send questions via Twitter at the hashtag at Carbon Talks. So.
Hello. My name is Puvana. I'm from SFU and work with a lab called Alternative Energy Conversion Lab. I have a generic question, which leads to another question, actually. According to your experience, which is the biggest barrier in for the radical change in achieving or working towards circular economy? Why I'm asking this question is, for example, if you take a textile industry, if you want to bring the circular fashion economy there, you might find a lot of resistance from the, for example, cotton growers. Will it affect, actually?
My strategy is to build coalitions of the willing and don't focus too much on those who in the end will not be sustainable anymore in a circular economy. And the more examples we put in practice, the more the various sectors should be aware of the changes that are taking place.
Hello, thank you for this very informative talk. My name is Alec. I'm affiliated to the Urban Studies here in SFU. I would like to ask you one question about financial arrangements. You are talking about circular economy while still keeping in mind profit and a linear financial model.
No.
I want to hear about that. I want to hear about how from growth we go to redistribution.
Yes. Well, this is a very important question you raise. In most of the cases, we come up with other business models. For instance, the example of circular demolition and construction of buildings. What is the aim? The aim is to demolish in a circular way, and we hire people with a distance from the labor market to do that work in order to give them jobs again. That's one. Secondly, in such a case, you need to work together among a number of groups, namely the demolition company, the recycler, the new, the company who is going to build the new building companies. Then you have, of course, the municipality or the in the case of some of the examples, the social housing corporation that is putting in place new homes for people. Well, all these people need to work in a new financial arrangement. Namely, the demolition company normally is doing the job of demolishing the building. Nobody knows the cost and benefits of doing that. If you go for a circular model, this demolition company should open his books and say, so much resources are stored in this particular building, and when I'm going to sell it, it's worth so much. That is part of the business case. Then the builder of the new home has to open his books as well, and in combination with these two parties, you can create a new business case, because you the value for your resources is higher, the cost of demolishing is also higher, but far less than what you gain through better high-value products. And in this way, you actually gain money instead of losing money overall. But this only works if there is cooperation in the supply chain. And there are many more examples also of product reuse. Perhaps one is very interesting for the audience is LED. The airport Schiphol has now set up an experiment with Philips to actually provide light in a certain area of the airport, and not LED lamps. It is actually a contract where Schiphol says, I need so much lumen, light, in so many years, 10 years, I want to be sure that everything is working. They pay for the light and not for the amount of lamps and for the electricity. Philips is actually the one who is organizing everything. Result, Philips comes up with the right lamps that indeed last long enough. They come up with enough light, but not too much light. So they are much keener on what they sell. And in that way, it triggers innovation in the company Philips. And in the meantime, it's a profitable business case for both.
If I may just pick up on that. So that sounds like a kind of performance-based contract.
Yeah, that's right.
And it's framed in terms of lumens, which is what the consumer wants. And just to think back, how would, before this had come into effect, how would Schiphol have contracted? Would they simply have, you know, installed their own lighting and just, you know, paid an electricity bill, or how would it have?
No, that beforehand, it was a part where they want to install new LED.
Right.
And then they there was a whole debate in the Netherlands why buy all the products that we use, why not lease it or have new financial arrangements. And then there was a company, Turn 2, that said, well, let's organize that together with the company Philips and the airport. So they helped to establish this deal.
So in effect, if I can just stay with this and then we'll go back to the other people asking questions, it's a real change in thinking, isn't it? Because this case, and it's applicable in many other sectors, in this case, the airport doesn't think about, well, we need to replace the lighting after so many years and we have to have, it's just an expenditure. They're thinking about, we need light as a service, and then create incentives for a service provider, in this case Philips, and figuring out how to do that in a way that's economically efficient to them. And it derives a kind of cooperation and a closer connection to the supply chain than would have been the case had you not structured it that way.
Yeah, well said.
Okay, good.
That's just how people would accuse them of outsourcing.
Right.
Because they're now not using their own staff.
Well, that is a good point.
Have to integrate that into the process.
Well, this is a very important point, because I have this conflict now in putting all these things in practice. And that is also the reluctance of, for instance, municipalities to move into this direction, because all these performance-based contracts imply that the responsibility of whether the contract is okay and whether it functions well is not anymore the responsibility of the municipality, but of the one that is on at the other side of the table. In the case of energy efficiency, we have this new way of thinking. We call them energy service companies. Well, you can put them in place, but in the municipality, you don't need 8 people anymore, but perhaps 1 or 2. So you shift indeed labor as well.
Let's just go back to this gentleman.
Thank you for the presentation and welcome to Vancouver. My name is Mahbod Rohani. I'm a co-founder of a company called Revivify. My question is about a local initiative, and I'll give a little bit of a background. We formed this company to address the 30,000 tons of textiles which end up in the landfill every year in Metro Vancouver, about 6,000 of which come from high-rises, and we provide free textile bins to high-rises with the service. We have a charity partner that provides this service, and they presented me with a challenge to solve. And the challenge is about furniture. They receive about a request for a donation of about £1.5 million of furniture every year that they turn down. And the reason is that the economics doesn't work for them.
Yeah.
And they ask me if I can find a solution for that. And the idea I have, so I have a partner, we have access to the furniture, and I have a logistic partner that can deliver it to any place I want. And what I'm thinking of is setting up centers where the furniture would come, be sterilized with heat treatment to make sure there are no bugs or anything, and then a designer would look at them, an interior designer, and we would use refugee skilled and sort of labor forces to work on the furniture and get the maximum value out of them and then sell them through four different channels. My question for you is, do you know of any successful examples of similar initiatives, and are there any resources or advice you would have for us?
Yes, what a wonderful example. We actually work in a quite similar direction, but then related to the furniture of offices. Often, offices replace their furniture every 7 years, while they are often in still very good condition, or some of them need to be refurbished, but in fact, it can be put back into the cycle as a product again. We have now several producers that make the business out of well, we don't use it as we say refurbished office furniture. Why? Because secondhand looks like it's no good. But it is fantastic. So when you see the furniture, you even can't see the difference between new. So now we want to put these kind of furniture into the market and help and support this idea. And what we now try to do is, via circular procurement, push that all the municipalities are not buying all new stuff, but think about these alternatives. So you have to close the loop. Otherwise, you have all this furniture, but who is going to buy it? And then it ends up in the second market again, if you don't take care of the loop. So my work is mainly related to how can we indeed close the overall loop and find the right players to build a consortium to make that happen. And preferably, not one producer of this kind of furniture should be in the market, because then we have a problem with circular procurement. But we promote that more pop up in order to have a choice in the market, and otherwise the market is not big enough. So we want to speed up the process of increasing that type of market. So this is a quite similar example. I'm very much in favor of your story, because it's product reuse first.
Black, I think you asked a question, and then this gentleman over here.
I hope to be a little bit shorter,
My name is Parm, and I'm from the Vancouver Economic Commission, and my question was about how you talked about how you were an initiator with like support, and I was wondering what the key steps were to like create like a business case, get the municipality and the city and other businesses involved in the circular economy. Like what led you there, and like what were like key barriers that you overcame?
Yeah. My strategy was as follows. First, we targeted a number of key resource streams, as I explained. And then we organized brainstorming sessions where we identified what is the state of the art now and what are the possibilities for much a better performance. And in this brainstorming session, we invited those people that are really into the field. Most of the time, there were 20 people max. Researchers, some people from industry, if necessary, also people who represented the municipalities. And with this group, we said, okay, what is the best we can do and what are the innovations coming up? So we really had a picture of the possible paths. And then the question is, okay, but when is it a viable business case? Then we go to some of the companies involved and say, okay, if you want to move into that direction, what is the precondition for you to invest in new business? Then you get a clear picture in a couple of conversations of what is actually necessary in order to really get people invest. If you know that, then you can organize that. And often that are just a couple of things. Very often it is, we want to have security of supply. We want to have also a demand in the market on which we can rely. That are crucial aspects. So we need, and that's what we are after, a deal with, for instance, municipalities that are willing to create the volume. And they need to sign and make a commitment for a longer term that they are willing to do that. Because if these preconditions are not fulfilled, then it's not going to work. So if we have done that, we can make a circular commitment with the consortium, which is really committed to make the change. And then I step back. So that is the approach I follow. And most of the time it works, and I don't think about barriers. I just think about where can I get connections that make it move.
Hi, Laurie Rimmer, Resourceful Paths Consulting. Just a question about metals. So most of the recycling metals in the world really involves shipping metals to places like China, where there's some questions about how environmentally sustainable that recycling is. So how do you assess what level of trade, which countries, for example, you would accept to send those metals to, what requirements you need to understand if that circular economy is actually working the way you want it in respect to metals?
What a wonderful question. This is a tough question because indeed we are struggling with recycling of metals. Most of the metal recycling is not taking place in the Netherlands, but is shipped to particularly China. Most of these metals are contaminated, and that is the problem. So what we are trying to push now, and I am in the process of hoping to prepare that, so I don't say that I get that done, but I hope to do that. We have various companies that are willing and equipped to clean metals. If we can make sure that that kind of activities take place in the Netherlands, we have clean metals, which are more valuable. And then we probably can sell this to, well, all kinds of companies in the Netherlands and in Europe and don't have to ship it elsewhere. That is my ideal picture of what we are going to do. The economics is really hard because, you know, the recyclers, but they call them recyclers, the metal recyclers, they say, yes, we just sell metals to those who pay a fair price. And we are not the ones who can change the game. So I understand their position, no doubt. But then I tell them, but if we can do it otherwise, then fine. If that is a new market, we are really willing to go for it. But now there is no market, so there is no other way than shipping it to China.
If I could just ask, and we'll take some more questions, from kind of, let's stand back maybe, you know, a few steps from the specific initiatives. In your mind, let's say you're coming to another country which has no, circular economy has not arrived in any significant way, and you're explaining, whether it's to a municipality or to a national government, what are the main, the sort of the, I mean, this project serves multiple ends, but what are the most important sort of social goods that you see instilling a circular economy is meant to address, and or which is it most successful at addressing?
Well, when I would address an audience in other parts of the world, I would first of all say it improved the well-being of the people. Because if you see now what is happening in some of the countries with burning all kinds of waste streams, which are really dangerous, and kids are trying to pick some of the materials which are valuable out of waste dumps, that is really terrible to see. So that would be my first thing. Mm-hmm. And then the second thing is, but if you turn this waste belt into, or the landfill, into a profitable business, because all these resources have value, you are economically also doing a better job. So, and then the question is, in some countries, they already have a very good system of separating waste, just because they these countries are still recognizing that resources are valuable and that they can get money for it. So you see all kinds of people who collect waste and try to sell it. So also that can be improved, and you have to make sure that you don't kill an infrastructure which is there, but build on the infrastructures that are there in order to make it beneficial for all the people.
Hi, my name is Andrea McKenzie. I work at the City of Vancouver in Solid Waste, and I've been working as part of a research collaborative, I'll call it, with folks in private industry and also Metro Vancouver on researching what happens in the region with apparel waste. So I was interested that the resource streams you chose to focus on first actually included non-wearable textiles, and that you described that had to do with it being two-thirds of the textile waste stream in the Netherlands as opposed to one-third being used mm-hmm. apparel. And so the reason that our research collaborative was focusing on apparel first is, to use your terminology, is that we felt we had a coalition of the willing around apparel. So my question is, when you're deciding which resource streams to prioritize, how much does the question of volume versus the question of coalition of the willing, you know, how do you prioritize one over the other in deciding where to focus?
Yeah. Well, coalition of the willing is the most important because you need support of front runners that really want to go for it. When I talk about non-wearables, it is part of the whole supply chain initiative, because we also have all kinds of new businesses around apparel sector in terms of reuse of, for instance, materials and making new nice clothes of these products. And also cradle-to-cradle approaches, design approaches. So I always try to team up with the new startups and new business developers in order to also show the products that can be developed in order to really cover the whole chain and not just the waste.
Okay, thank you.
If I could ask about Both regulation and pricing, what kind of external and what waste streams are incentives that outside of what the existing economy would generate are necessary in order to get these alliances going? On which ones is there a business case currently, just given the value of the material? And if you get the right entrepreneurs coming forward, people with business, imaginative business ideas stepping in, that they'll begin to take off?
Well, all the examples I provided need to end up in positive business cases, and most of them already do. The case of the metals is still a problem, but that's why we are working on it. We don't have that many tax incentives that stimulate the circular economy. We have low taxes for instance, repair. No VAT, or hardly any VAT. Yeah, so in that sense, there is some incentives, but still that is not enough because the labor costs are high. And in the shops, they tell us, you know, doesn't make sense to repair because it's too expensive. So, and I always hate that kind of remarks, but it is still a problem. We are not managing in such a way that people think, oh, well, it is also profitable to do it. So, I hope that is an answer to your question.
I was thinking, is it important to have things like municipal regulations either banning or fining for certain kinds of waste disposal or non-recycling, or even the equivalent of like the way the carbon price serves to... to create incentives for energy efficiency or switcher to low carbon energy?
Well, in the Netherlands, it's national politics, and most of the bans we can introduce need to be introduced at national level. Yeah. For instance, we have a ban on free plastic bags. And that works very well, but couldn't be introduced in one city. That's the limitation. There is a ban on landfilling. So we need at least to incinerate, but there we also have restrictions of what you can incinerate. And the developments of recycling have already been put in have been started, I can better say, in the late 1980s of the previous century. So we have quite some experience with low-grade recycling. And there we have the producer responsibility measure as actually the trigger to get things off the ground. But still, that's not an optimal scheme for getting high-value recycling.
Thank you. My name is David Gregg, and I have a question which addresses perhaps a more international aspect of the circular movement of goods from beginning to end and back again. So we could take the example of Philips, an international company of great repute. But it would seem obvious that many of the resources used by Philips are not one or resourced within Netherlands. So perhaps some of the items come from overseas.
Many.
Thank you. So here's the question. As we move towards free trade between Canada, Europe and other countries, it seems that there's a greater opportunity for globalized companies to extract and win resources from the lowest common denominator countries. So my question is, how do you see us moving forward to secure a circular economy when in fact it's the circular economies that you're talking about are small bubbles within a much larger international zone?
Yeah. This is a very fundamental question and a good question. Of course, that is the case. That it's what I'm talking about is just a small piece of a bigger pie. And the example of metal recycling already showed how difficult it is to make a closed loop. Also, the international trade doesn't promote being circular. What actually happens in the Netherlands at the moment, but it's a broader topic, but relates to your question, is that we are now, and we too have already been agreed, we set up agreements, sectoral agreements, on corporate social responsibility internationally. And these agreements, which are actually decided upon by the main actors, namely industry and NGOs and trade unions and the government, and together they make sure that the sector is not only operating in terms of people, planet, and profit in an appropriate way in the Netherlands, but also abroad. I actually chaired an agreement, a sectoral agreement, in the banking sector, which has been agreed upon half a year ago. And that's, of course, a very powerful tool if the banks are going to, set the standards for CSR internationally. That has an enormous implications of how we deal in the rest of the world.
Well, I think we've come to the end of our time. So I'd just like to say a couple of quick announcements before we thank our speaker. This talk will be archived and will go up on the Carbon Talks YouTube channel in about a week's time. Our next Carbon Talk will be in 2 weeks on Tuesday, the 28th of March, and that'll be delivered on the title of Implementing the Pan-Canadian Framework on Climate Change, and that'll be the Parliamentary Secretary to the Minister for Environment and Climate Change, Jonathan Wilkinson, who of course is the MP for North Vancouver. So he'll be here in this room giving that talk. I hope you can join us. I should also say in 2 months' time here at SFU, we're organizing what we call our Renewable Cities Global Learning Forum, which will touch on these issues, but with a strong concentration on energy and energy efficiency. And we'd be delighted to tell you more about that. You can find that as well on our website. I should thank our funders once again for this series, North Growth Foundation, Pacific Institute for Climate Solutions, and the Center for Dialogue. And again, special thanks to the UBC Killam Connection, which brought Dr. Cramer to Vancouver this week. So if you allow me to thank Jacqueline again for her great presentation.